And also this brainwashing thing doesn't only happen in the sphere of religion, right? It happens in every other field also. There are people who are manipulating others and making them believe. But yeah, it happens everywhere. Like you mentioned the other day, how we were brainwashed about certain events, certain world events.
Correct.
Right. Can you elaborate about it?
Are always being brainwashed by leaders who are in power. Remember this, that people can only come to power when they have the collective approval of the masses. And to get the collective approval of the masses, they will play along with the sentiments of the masses and get from them what exactly they want. Okay, so suppose if there is a nation that's constantly seeking some sort of glorification of its country, then the world leaders from that country will say, see, we have an enemy in that country and they are a threat to us, and our whole mission in life is to go and attack them, whereas they were really never a problem. But this is being controlled by world leaders, by bankers, by industrialists to get an edge over that country. So the sentiment of the people is they want to make their nation great, but then these leaders will use that to their advantage to have something to be gained from them. So just like this, there is brainwashing in every sense, and it is not that easy to come out of it. It's not just in the religious sphere. It is 100% more in the political sphere. It is a lot more in the sociological sphere as well. And it is literally there everywhere. We just need to know to precisely say where we are being brainwashed and where we are being manipulated is very hard to say. But what we do need to know at any given point of time is whenever we hear anything, whenever we come across any sort of opinion, the first thing to do is to not side with it. The first thing to do is just listen to it. And the best way to neutralize any sort of brainwashing is to not just listen to that kind of opinion which is pleasing to you and your personality, but you should be strong enough to be able to give your ear to the people who are against your views or against the views that you've just heard about. You've got to keep them together. This is the only way we can have an awakened sense of citizenship amongst people all over the world. You've got to hear both. You've got to keep them with you for a long, long time. Sometimes your bias towards one particular view will not even allow you to agree with it. And then you have to look at your dissent and what's against your views. You've got to see why they think the way they think. People usually say, I hate him for the way he thinks. I don't appreciate him for the way he thinks. That's not the way to go about it. Why does he think the way he thinks? It's very important to go into that. And that's the only way you can be saved from any degree, not like an ultimate degree of manipulation. It will be there. If you watch The Social Dilemma on Netflix, you will see how even the most harmless thing, like the social media platforms are so powerful in creating algorithms to create a sense of divisiveness amongst us, right? It's happening just in a simple algorithm with the cute looking CEOs of great social platforms, but they are, the breeding houses of divisive manipulation. So it's literally there everywhere. Like, I'll just give you an example, right? So when I was in my particular thing about the political scenario, I had a particular bias and I would search Facebook for that. And I would watch videos that are in line with my bias for some time. But then I realized I would only get this kind of thing, right? And then I realized, okay, that means so many people are talking about my views. How can these people go against it? Then I started watching their videos. And then I saw that I would get feeds of all the views that they had. And one thing it helped me to search both is that I realized that I can have a neutral stand and I can see what's the problem with what I support and what is a good thing about it. I can see what's the problem with what I don't support and what's a good thing about it as well. And lucky for me, in the particular, political scenario, I was able to keep a balanced head in that moment. That's how you kind of neutralize it.
And the last thing I want people to know is that people think that spirituality is something that is not rational, logical. I want to want you to tell that spirituality is one of the most, you know, do you apply your mind and only, I heard from you many times that you say that only personality and breathing, only when it feels appealing to you, then you can take it in. Otherwise, anything that is contradictory to rationality, that is not something which we call as spirituality. So I would like to hear that from you. How rationality and spirituality goes hand in hand?
It's a good question. See, the thing is, spirituality has to be very scientific. Okay. Now, when we say scientific, from the general sense of science, we assume, you know, taking data from outside, we assume corroborating the data, we assume bringing about a hypothesis and trying to see how that hypothesis is not correct, right?
Right.
So that's how we approach science in an objective world. Just like that, we approach spirituality from the subjective sense with that perspective. That is, we are here, or the enlightenment teachers are there to tell you that you are not merely your body, you're not merely your mind, you're something beyond that. That even without the body, you continue to exist. Without the mind, you do not have to fear that your identity will be destroyed. You are, when you identify with that reality inside you, you are far more powerful within yourself. You are empowered, you're far more free, and you're far more encompassing in your love and association with the whole of humanity. Now, this is what is a hypothesis that is told, but it has been a hypothesis that has been declared by people who have realized that truth. Now, it's for us to scientifically inquire how this is wrong. That's the good way to go about it. Instead of, you know, just putting your faith based and saying, oh yeah, yeah, this guru has told it, this teacher has told it, yes, I'm not my body, I agree with it. No, you go to see how I am my body and how the teacher is wrong. You will see that all these things do not stand to reason. There are scientific evidences also that are proving that this limitation of our body is actually a very limited part of our entity. In fact, we exist with it only for 16 hours. The rest of the hours, we have no identification with it, right? And that is, and if this is something that is me, it should be eternally with me all the time. This is how you use logic and rational to find out your real nature. So this body cannot be that. What about the mind? Now, this mind is something that I have been believing is me. Whatever my emotions come, whatever the ideas come, I have been very closely associated with that. I've been saying that I am this. But we just need to apply a little bit of rationality and memory and see that this mind has been changing for literally every 6 months. And to something that has been changing, how do I identify myself? Right? I cannot identify myself. When I was a kid, I had one ideology and I thought that was great. Everything is seeming to be great and vanishing before me. And therefore, how do I identify with this? So this is what's changing, right? The body is changing. The body is limited. The mind's limited. Inquire into that. And also inquire into the fact that in spite of this changing nature, every one of us can not deny that there is something unchanging in me. Things have changed, but I feel I am. I feel I exist. I feel that I have been there all this time. But whatever I have associated that I have been there has been changing. Right? My body has changed, my mind has been changed. Trying to say, there is a background that is unchanging in you, and there is a layer on top of it with which you manifest in this world, which is changing. Just find that out and make peace within yourself. And this is what spirituality in its most logical sense is. And what we are saying is, or what spirituality does say is, don't agree to what is being said. Question it. Mm-hmm. Reason it.
Exactly.
Okay. So it is the basis, the foundation of spirituality. Swami Vivekananda used to stress on it a lot. He used to question his guru, Sri Ramakrishna, for 6 years continuously to ensure that the ecstasies that Sri Ramakrishna was going in was not hallucination of his brain, right? And he stressed the fact that I need to know for sure that these are not your hallucinations. I need to figure it out for myself. Now, how do you figure out something that you see outside is true or not? You validate it within, right? So the other thing that I would want to say is, when people say spirituality is not true, right, and it doesn't exist, that is as good as an ignorant man saying that just because there are clouds, there is no sun. you know, if one really wants to disprove the truth of the spiritual concepts, then one has to practice it himself, come to that conclusion himself. You can't be sitting by a chair drinking some coffee and, you know, among some friends who are critical of you and just say, ah, it doesn't exist. There are people who have given their time and energy into it, you know, so it's for them to figure out. It's as logical and as open as it's open to experimentation, it's open to inquiry, and it's open to rationale, and it's there for you to take. So that's how simple spirituality is.
Yes, thank you so much for your time, and it's a very nice conversation. Thanks for explaining all of it to us.
Thank you. Thank you, Vinisha.
Thank you. We'll meet next time.